A very good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the launch of NUS Press latest publication, Singapore and the Silk Road of the Sea, 1300 to 1800. I'm Chen, your MC for tonight, and I'm also proud to say I'm a second generation Singaporean archaeologist. Good evening. Good evening, Professor Dr. John Miksic, Mr. Chong Guan, the guest of honor for today, Your Excellencies, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, friends. We are happy and honored to have you join us for tonight's opening and reception of a very special launch for the Singapore and the Silk Road of the Sea. Today is another important milestone for Singapore archaeology, as next year we celebrate our 30th anniversary of digging in Singapore. Archaeology is a very young discipline, and it only began in 1984. While many of us know of John Miksic as the pioneer archaeologist of Singapore, few realized that the true godfather of Singapore archaeology is none other than our own guest of honor, Mr. Chong Guan. 30 years ago, he befriended John and lured him to Singapore with promises of exciting finds. The finds were certainly enticing, and John stayed in Singapore for the next 3 decades. Mr. Kwan was not only a matchmaker of a very obscure event 30 years ago, these past 3 decades he has steadfastly championed our archaeological cause. When sites came under threat of development, he found funding for the digs where others failed. More importantly, he lobbied for permits and extracted approvals and twisted arms from landowners and state agencies just for us to excavate. Today, as what he had done, we are grooming yet another generation of Singaporean archaeologists to continue his work. Without further ado, I would like to invite the Chairman of the Board of the National Archives, Mr. Kwa Chong Guan, to speak about this event. Godfather, please.
Dr. Garmin, sir. Chen, I must thank you very much for that over-generous introduction. Actually, I think grandfather, the start of this archaeology in Singapore, should go to Dr. John Crawford, who visited Singapore in February 1822 en route to the courts of Siam and Cochin China as an emissary of the Marquis of Hastings. And on the morning of the 3rd of February, he walked around what he termed the walls and limits of the ancient town of Singapore, and he climbed up the hill at the center of this ancient town. And Dr. Crawford left us some notes of what he saw on the hill, and they were more detailed than what Raffles, who also had a declared interest in the antiquities of this settlement that he founded, has left us. Let me say that. I'm delighted that in 1983, John, then lecturing at Gajamada University, accepted an invitation from the old National Museum to come and plan and direct the first systematic archaeological excavation on Fort Canning. And as Chen says, I really also need a very small role to put my museum colleagues in contact with an old friend I've known since the early 70s, Chen, not since the early 70s, I've known John already. And I had the opportunity to then join John in trying to make sense of what Dr. Crawford saw on Fort Canning in 1822 and what we were seeing in 1984 in deciding where to dig what trench. And really, it was a gamble we were taking, as there was a high probability we would find nothing on the hill after all those developments of the fort and the reservoir and all of that. So, the rest is history, as you know. You say the excavation results have been reported in some detail by John, and that report was the beginning of the next 25, now I think 30 years of further excavations on not only Fort Canning but also its environs. And that report also was in part, I mean, the justification for the National Parks Board and the History Department at the National University of Singapore to jointly invite John to join their staff and extend the invitation started in 1984. The volume that we are gathered to launch this evening is the summation of the observations John has undertaken in this quarter century. So, Singapore and the Silk Road of the sea, 1300 to 1800, will, I think, become the definitive text that we will all have to henceforth refer to for an understanding of why and how, what sites on and around Fort Canning and along the Singapore River were excavated. So the volume here provides an analytical overview of what was recovered from these excavations. What are the future? Where do we go from here? I have no doubt that John and the emerging generation of archaeologists that he has nurtured, like Lim Chen Sian, Bo Yo Yen, will continue to excavate for as long as they can get permission and funding to do so, but more importantly, the volunteers from among all of you here to support and help here. Chen has coordinated excavations at the Victoria Memorial Hall before its current renovations. He has also excavated at the National Art Gallery. These excavations were, I think, undertaken after John completed his text of his book and are therefore not included. And I think we're now going to look forward to Chen's report of his excavations, and I hope we will not wait 25 years already. So, I would think here that making this collection more widely available for study is the next step here. How do we do it? John has done the pioneering work of analyzing the artifacts in his book to tell us about what was being produced in Singapore on Fort Canning in the 14th century, what was being produced, and how what we found on Fort Canning relates to those of other sites around Singapore, particularly the Riyadhs. But I think, like any other category of historical evidence, archival records, historical documents, photographs, maps, they are capable of alternative readings and interpretations, and likewise with the archaeological evidence, others can and should be allowed to attempt to make different and alternative interpretations of this evidence here. In the archive today, we're doing this through digitalization, as in the National Library, where the chair of the National Archives, as Chen has pointed out. So, the technology of digitalization today enables these archival records to be made, to be scanned and digitalized, to be more available. Likewise, the archaeological evidence we have recovered can and should be digitalized so that it can be made readily available and researched by a wider community of archaeologists, scholars, and all those who are interested in our history. I therefore look forward to John and his doughty team of assistants and volunteers to move archaeology into this next stage. And on behalf of all of us here this evening and others elsewhere who have an interest in Singapore's past, I would like to thank John for his passion, his commitment to making 14th century Damascus, Singapore, one of the best archaeologically documented ports of trade in Southeast Asia. Thank you, John.
Just about a month and a couple of days ago, the Chinese Premier Xi Jinping made a historical visit to Indonesia.
He was actually the first foreign head of state to address the Indonesian parliament. In the context of President Barack Obama's failure to turn up in Asia, that made this occasion even more meaningful, I think. And I believe we'll see this as an event of some significance looking back. Now, despite the esteemed presence of Mr. Kwa Chung Wan, who in addition to his knowledge of Singapore's ancient history, is a savvy observer of international affairs and a staff member at the Roger Rogers School of International Studies, I don't want to talk about your international relations and politics. But I'd like to draw your attention to the metaphor that Premier Xi used in talking about China's relationship with Southeast Asia. Southeast Asia is an important leg of the maritime Silk Road, he declared. Of course, I'd prefer it if the translator had said, of the Silk Road of the Sea. You know, it might have helped sales a little bit more, but still, it's a good formulation. And he used it quite often in his speech as a way of marking China's many links with Southeast Asia and ASEAN and its focus on the region. Not only are the Chinese working to increase maritime cooperation with Southeast Asia, whatever that means, he said, according to reports of his speech, that this new maritime Silk Road would be the focus of a diamond decade, the next 10 years of golden exchange and cooperation. Now, he was looking ahead and speaking of the future, and I'm not sure it'll be quite so bling as, so golden and diamond-studded as he envisaged, but let's hope so. We can't say much about the future, but now, in the book that John has written, we can say some things about the past. And we can certainly say that anyone who wants to write about Singapore's past needs to take this work into account. And as Mr. Kwa said, he's also working on that for his 700-year history, which we're watching quite carefully. John's book is ambitious. It covers a long stretch of time. We put it in a subtitle, Singapore Silk Road of the Sea, 1300 to 1800. I can't think of a better echo of the forces at play in the long-term and deep history of the region than Premier Xi's use of the same phrase in this historic speech. This long duration, I don't intend to also refer to our launch, so I'll try to bring my remarks to a close. We actually had a guest say, why is your book launch so long? You're like, it's just a humble book launch, gathering of friends, it's not that long. No, but you're starting at 1 o'clock and you're ending at 6. Well, 1300 to 1800. at the time of the launch. So I want to thank you for getting the time right, and my deepest apologies to anyone who came at 1 o'clock and we weren't here. I'm very sorry for the confusion. Those of you in the know might also, you can be forgiven for wondering about the long time it took to produce the book, but the book is here, and let me tell you, it is worth it. And I should add that it's not definitive. There's more work to be done, more reports to be published, and more excavations to do. And in fact, in December, there'll be a new excavation on the site of the Asian Civilizations Museum in this place. So there's much more to be done, and this is just the beginning, but it is a tremendous work of synthesis, not only of John's own work, but of the work of marine archaeology in the region over these last 25 years. So let me conclude. We're thrilled to have played our part in publishing this. We're thrilled to have worked with the National Museum to have done so. We're very pleased to have Mr. Kwa launch the book for us as guest of honor for reasons I think you will understand having heard his speech. We're thrilled to have you here as our guests. Many of you played a part in cajoling, pushing, encouraging different institutions to help in different ways. Many of you were volunteers. I myself did at least one last-minute rescue of artifacts at Pulau Saigon, and I treasure that memory greatly. Our role is really as publishers, and publishing Singapore history is very important to us. So we're pleased to play our small part in helping you towards the common goal of further research in the archaeology and history of Singapore. Thank you.
Thank you, Peter. Before we call on John onto the stage to deliver his lecture, I have been tasked to say a few things about him. Unfortunately, they gave me a script, so it's easy, right? Instead of giving you a rundown of his CV, which is about 28 pages long, if you allow me to be indulgent, I'd like to share with you some personal anecdotes that demonstrate the extent of his accomplishments throughout Southeast Asia. As archaeologists, you probably know we travel a lot. like maybe it's a romantic nature of it, but we do. We travel a lot, and naturally we like to visit museums, sites, or archaeological, historical, or heritage importance. Or sometimes we just like to poke our noses into landscapes to see what's buried there. From all these travels, I've come to realize that in the region, many people recognize the John Miksic brand name, just as you recognize a Prada or Chanel. Often, when local counterparts discover that John is my teacher, my colleague, and my boss, they will bring a smile of recognition, and the hospitality will increase by several notches. In Indonesia, it is known as Pak John. In Cambodia, Prof John. In China, Mi Si Xian Shen. Once in Singapore, I was at a police station filling up some minor report for some misdemeanor. When the duty inspector looked at my papers, which I scrawled archaeologist under the column that says occupation, his professional poker face melted away, smiled at me knowingly, and said, "Ah, John Miksic, I have volunteered digging at Fort Canning." Now please welcome Professor Dr. John Miksic, the author of this book.
Almost everybody in this room has been a critical part of my last 25 years, almost 30 years now of research. Without many of the people in this room all working together, this would not have happened. Every one of those pieces of this puzzle has been essential to creating a wholly new profile for Singapore identity. And one of the greatest things about being an archaeologist is that it's a team sport. It's not an individual game. It's something where a lot of people have to work together to achieve something. And the more people who work together who can actually feel like they're part of the same calling, it is really more of a calling. It's not so much a profession as it is you feel like you really personally need to do it. And there are so many people in this room who felt that they needed to do it even though I meant going out and working in the hot sun, spending a long time getting bitten by mosquitoes and so forth, they felt that it was necessary for their own spiritual well-being. So I've just been lucky that I've been one member of this very large team. I happen to be here first along with a very few people from the National Museum at the time. And of course, it was all due to Chong Guan originally. Without his initiative, none of this ever would have come to pass. So, the second nice thing about being an archaeologist is that it is something that you can be any age. You can play it anywhere from 5 years old to 100 years old. And I've had the whole range of people working as an archaeologist, so it's not limited to any shape, form, or age of personality, but it's something that we can actually all do together.